Adani Institute of Infrastructure Management. On behalf of AIIM and KPMG, I welcome you to this timely and relevant discussion on managing stakeholder expectations, especially in the context of a crisis. Let me introduce the experienced speakers who are leaders in their profession. We have Karan Marwa, partner KPMG, with expertise in financial reporting, regulatory and capital markets. He has consulted to many clients, both locally and globally. Welcome, Karan. Our second speaker, Nitin Parekh, needs no introduction. A versatile person who has won 16 awards over the last decade, he is the CFO of Zydus Group, with deep insights on the enlarged role of a modern CFO and the understanding of the many stakeholder issues of the organization. Incidentally, he joins us after just completing his investor conference. Welcome, Nitin. Our third speaker, Kaushal Shah, is the CFO of Adani Transmission and has rich experience in mobilizing resources, especially from global markets, and regularly interacts with investors. He will share with us the extended dimensions of stakeholder management. Welcome, Kaushal. Let's begin. You can put your questions in the chat box whenever you feel like doing that. Our team will handle that. Next. What is COVID crisis? This picture tells all. The havoc that it created since last 4 months. The next slide covers the market impact of the two crises in the past, the Great Depression of 1929 and the global financial crisis of 2009. These earlier crises triggered reforms and large governmental interventions. We see a similar story in COVID-19 crisis, but this time the emphasis has shifted. It's all about focus on safety of human lives. I don't know how the curve will span out, but as a crisis has its three stages, beginning, middle, and end, we will of course see the end of this and recovery. We will focus our discussions on four areas: how the COVID crisis has impacted the business operations, how will it has affected the market valuations, and how it has enlarged the stakeholder management. Plus, there are lots of new opportunities that have come up from this crisis. Our speakers will talk at length from their personal experiences. As you are all the stakeholders, we first invite you to a short 30-second poll and gather your views about how leaders should manage a crisis. Please vote. Thank you. We'll get the results very soon. Now to the first focus area of the impact on the business operations. Over to you, Karan.
Thank you very much, Devang Bhai, and it's a pleasure to be here. I think we are all living in unprecedented times, and that word has been used more often than not in the last few days especially. I think what we are looking at today is obviously the topic that we will be discussing is how companies should be looking at managing stakeholder expectations during this time. And as they say, every crisis creates an opportunity So we'll also look at some positive attributes coming out of this crisis. But really, if we step back and look at what's been happening over the last, I think, close to 90 days, especially in India, since we were in lockdown and now coming out of it, we've seen a very large-scale disruption to supply chains. And I think that's something that has happened not just in India, across the world, and at I think at all levels, you know, impacting all of us as consumers, all our businesses, you know, no matter which sort of sphere we operate in. And that's still unraveling as we speak. I think we all are acutely aware of the issues we've had around, you know, the safety of our migrant labor and the challenges we've now faced in terms of having to deal with a lot of them wanting to, you know, return to their villages, you know, justifiably so. But then that creating an issue in terms of really when we are now looking at starting or re-emerging from the lockdown and starting production again, how do we ensure that we have adequate trained labor force? Of course, the softer aspects here, how do we keep people safe? How do we bring them back into the workforce? How do we keep them, you know, safe and secure? I think we've also seen, and I think this will continue to, I guess, gather some pace, a lot of defaults in contracts, a number of companies invoking force majeure clauses. And again, given the state of the economy, both global and local, I don't think we've seen the end of that. Clearly, from a financial markets perspective, liquidity has been a challenge. A number of companies have struggled with, you know, keeping afloat in terms of having access to working capital. Interestingly, the we've also seen a lot of activity in terms of debt raising, where a number of companies have gone to the market and raised a large volume of debt, mostly to refinance existing obligations. We've also seen some large equity issuances, especially by one of our largest you know, telecom companies in the country. And that's been an interesting trend. But really what we're facing, obviously, I think as a consequence of all of this is a very severe decline in top line. And as a consequence, of course, the bottom line. I think there's been a lot of debate on what the shape of the recovery will be. And, you know, virtually exhausting all the alphabets in the alphabet soup. But again, we'll have to wait and see how, again, I think the one large challenge I see is that there's a lot of uncertainty in terms of how will the economy recover and also the longevity of the lockdown. Because while I think we've now virtually unlocked a lot of our economy, there continue to be phases where we'll have to possibly lock down again when infections spike in particular areas. And we've seen some of that. Again, from a volatility perspective, I think if you look at what's happening with commodities, or even with financial instruments, there has been a spike in volatility. Oil, I would imagine a lot of our viewers would know the, you know, the fluctuation in the price of oil and the new lows it touched at a certain point during this crisis. Of course, it's come back from that low, but again, you know, how much of that will be sustainable, and then what will be the future with that? And then, of course, you know, again, as a consequence of the disruption, a number of closures in terms of you know, production and supply chains. So I think the one question we get asked often is that, you know, how do you see this play across sectors? And I think I can safely say all sectors have been impacted, some more so than others. But clearly a few sectors are or have emerged as I would say beneficiaries to an extent. I think with the shift in consumption, with the anxiety that this crisis has brought forward, with the health issues and the focus on health, there are clearly sectors that are doing well. And we'll talk through some of that today with some of our other panelists too. Yeah. So those are my initial thoughts. I'll hand it back to you.
Thanks, Karan. I think you have summed up the broader issues that the businesses are feeling. I mean, some they are being exposed to right now. More important is that there is no definite way in which how this is going to end. So people are struggling in many ways. The things are, the overall, the cross-border transactions are also happening very differently. Nitin, why don't you tell us something about what is happening in your sector?
Yes, Dhanbhai, thank you for this opportunity. I think as you would have learned from the market and also when Karan mentioned about different sectors having different impact, Fortunately, pharma and healthcare in general were the least affected, because these days what everybody is talking about, what is there as a cure or treatment or mitigation measure for COVID. What really helped a company like us, and we must all thank technology, how it has come to our rescue, though we may not very clearly or expressly many times recognize the importance of technology, but I think this really helped in terms of business continuity plan. We had fortunately prepared this plan just in February when COVID was known, and thinking that this may possibly have a larger impact, and therefore how do we ensure that our business would continue. So our IT team, along with the help of other people, prepared complete plan in terms of what it means if there is a lockdown, even prior to having a lockdown already announced in India, because it was already announced somewhere else. We thought that this is going to come to India also soon. Now, SAP as a system, I think, is a great boon in today's time, because we allowed access from home and many other places, including auditors were able to do many audit work from SAP, access given to them. So work from home, how exactly this will be done, we had very clearly laid down the entire plan of that. Office 360, cloud-based access again helped, compared to the normal, enterprise, where we have everything on site. And when we moved to our new office at Zydus Corporate Park, just before Diwali, we decided not to carry any laptops. We said all the laptops would be, desktops. We decided all the desktops to be replaced by laptops. So that actually helped in terms of working from home. So I think this is the way technology is really helping us. Yeah. In this operations time, the message to top management team were broadly on three counts. One is, how do we manage and control cost, keeping the operation and impact of COVID in mind? How do we preserve liquidity? So we decided to prioritize certain payments, and we laid down, let's say, employee payments, then statutory payments, or payments related to continuity of business, payments are related to financial institutions, banks, and like that. And within that also, there were priorities laid down. For example, when it comes to making payment to creditors, the creditors which are MSME sector or single source supplier, or those who are much more dependent on us, would obviously get priority. Like this, there were rules laid down to handle productivity, liquidity, and in the process, how do we sustain the business operations? We also established in a very formal manner liquidity management office. So this office, along with the help of strategy and business team, worked out scenarios of business. And we have different business, like within pharma, we have animal health, human health, then we have Zydus Wellness, which is sort of FMCG kind of business. Then we have multiple businesses related to pharma, but overseas, like US, France, Spain, Philippines, German, Philippines. Then we are also in Thailand, we are also in Myanmar, we are in South Africa, and like that. So each of these have different kind of lockdown and different kind of restrictions and implications. And therefore, we run scenario of all of them on revenue, cost, profit, and cash flows. And also worked out on a contingency plan. We changed the authority matrix in terms of certain discretionary spends to control those expenses. We also laid down the principles. Principle, just to give example, that when my spend department will ask what is the liquidity which will be made available in a particular month for payments to various parties. So we, based on the cash flow for the month, we would give a visibility of cash outflow in terms of payments. Now that's just the visibility part, there's not a commitment part. But we worked on a week-to-week basis. So week one's inflows will be used for week two's outflows, and week two's inflows for week three's outflows. So commitment were all based on actual, and the visibility was given based on projection. I think that worked very well for us. And we have been happy to say now that we have been very successful in establishing liquidity management office to monitor the cash flows. Also better control over working capital, whether inventory, receivable, or creditors. On receivable, it worked both ways. Like, we went for a cash discount scheme for certain parties, and we also went for extension of credit for the other parties. So both ways it worked. And creditors, as I mentioned, the priority of payments, including MSME payments, we decided. Handling of supply chain bottlenecks, I think Karan also touched upon this point. Like, while pharma is essential, initially it also created a problem in terms of understanding and interpreting the guidelines. the transportation of medicine was not considered essential by some of the districts and local people. They said pharma is essential, but where is transport mentioned? So we had to actually go back to government, get notification, circulars, clarification issued. Fortunately, I must mention this, that government machinery was very fast in reacting to all requirements to all help the industry, and especially pharma, considering that essential goods industry. We also looking at the different markets and different lockdowns, decided how do we allocate our manufacturing capacity to different markets in the light of what's required, in terms of most efficient way of allocating capacities. Also working on new business opportunities. You would have heard that Zydus works on vaccines for COVID. We are supplying kits and manufacturing kits for ICMR. We are amongst the largest global players for HCQS, which is considered as a treatment. Also remdesivir and dexamethasone, which are currently in talked about. So we are present in all this, and we also created a directory of all kinds of government benefits. Country has come out with different kind of guidelines, whether they are of benefits to employees, bank related benefits, interest related benefit, payment deferment, etc. So the global directory is prepared by us for all the countries that we operate. I think that also helps us in terms of not only sustaining the operations efficiently, but also having a reasonable growth.
Just to announce the poll that we took, and as expected, most of the people say that the leader of an organization should manage a crisis by taking a holistic view of challenges and opportunities and motivating people for collective contribution. I think that's what really the thrust is on. Thanks, Nitin. Kaushal, what has been your experience on the operation front?
Thank you, Devang bhai and Nitin, for this clear understanding that how the pharma industry is being managed. And Karan, at the initial stage, gave us the idea about how the sectors are impacted. So let me tell you that we are into the energy sector, whereby we are into transmission and distribution business. And this sector is part of classified as an essential services. So we have to make sure that uninterrupted power supply is available at the various location. And more importantly, when we are the, we are serving 3 million households and various hospitals and the various essential services in Mumbai, whereby we have to ensure that in this COVID times, we make power available to them without any interruption. So what we have done, I would broadly classify it, and Nitin has already covered that. So I would classify it that overall what we have done from the employee perspective, safety perspective. The second, what I will do is that what will be the liquidity kind of things which will be required, then the, the supply chain, what we have done. And in this, how we have managed our internal financial reporting and control, and the overall what is the financial impact and supply chain management. So in that, first, if you look at this, what we have done to make sure that we are not impacted on the, so we at various locations of our substation, we quarantine our employees over there to make sure that the services of transmission remains uninterrupted. With the all the hygienic factors being taken care of at that particular locations. The second important point which we have done is that in our distribution business, we have a supervisory control system where we have a decentralized it to the four locations. And we have a Dhanu power plant, which is remote around 80 kilometers from Mumbai. So we created a 24/7 customer care center. So anybody is having any issue at that particular location, that issue can be immediately addressed. And the employees are also being provided the safety measures. We provided them with the safety kit. We have a hygiene. There is a guideline available from the HR, the remote functioning technological transformation, which we have done, whereby the employees were almost 75% of the employee currently are working from the home. And we have facilitated the entire technological setup to make sure that this remains uninterrupted. And we provided the clear-cut guideline from the human resource about the how the as per the who and what are the important steps which are being which should be taken by the employees, because safety is our the largest priority. The second point which we have done is the cash flow, because cash flow in this environment was very, very important. So we have ensured that throughout this period, we have minimum 2x liquidity available compared to our obligation. So this we do not know, because how long it will run, but we have provided that at least for 9 to 12 months, we are fully secured. And since we are an internationally rated investment grade company, you know, I will cover up at the later part, but the rating agency also looks this as a very, very positive, because our top line and the bottom line both are not being impacted. Only the receivables are being impacted, whereby we used to receive these in 30 and 45 days, but the government has given some relaxation to the DISCOMs. Now we are getting it around 60 to 70 days. But still the cash flow is very, very important. So for this kind of an environment, this is another very important point. Then what we have ensured is the supply chain, whereby we have made sure that we provide support to the smaller vendors, who in turn has helped us to provide the materials timely on the site, as well as we maintained the inventory to run the uninterrupted operation and maintenance activity. So that is another important point, that how do you manage your operation and maintenance without any, you know, lack of the spare parts and other things which is available. Then what we did was that we are the very few company who has done the board meeting of the Q4 in early May. So all of that thing, we have done it through the WebEx, and this has been done very, very successful on this. We also did the integrated reporting in this environment, which covers the environment, social, and the governance. All of these things which we have done. So overall—
So Kaushal, from a point of view of this crisis, what is your, all of you, I mean, what are you saying that? Were you ready for this crisis? Or are there any lessons for the business and operations that we need to do it slightly differently for the next thing? Hopefully it doesn't come very fast, it comes. Are we geared to that? From the operational perspective, what is your view on that? Any of you can tell us?
So Devang bhai, you know, I would say that you know, the big learning which we have done is that the business cannot wait for any transformation. So this is a continuous process, and earlier we have already done that. That has helped us a lot to, you know, maintain the business uninterrupted. So that is the biggest learning which we had. Then the second important point is that the meaning of the word essential, we could very well now establish that what is essential and what is non-essential. And most important thing is the leadership and value matters always, but especially more importantly in this crisis environment. And we as a management team have worked cohesively to make sure that we come over the crisis very effectively.
Nitin, what is your suggestion? I mean, we are ready or we need to do more?
I think there is always a scope for doing more, whether it is employee safety or employee welfare measures or, you know, communication and other things. I think most companies are doing their, you know, bit in terms of what is required, but I think there is always scope to do something better than this, something more than that.
Thanks, Nitin. Karan, from a point of view of consulting background, you feel that a lot of situations could have been avoided. People talk that whether this is a black swan or whether it could have been avoided. What is your view on that?
So I think in hindsight, one can always find answers to and rationalize everything, right? And you and I were debating yesterday whether or not this is a black swan, but I think safe to say, one, I don't think any of us were, you know, fully prepared or geared up for such a large crisis. And I think just in terms of scale and the extent of disruption this has caused. While I think, I think the one dimension I wanted to bring in here was, you know, this whole concept of enterprise-wide risk management. I think if you, as you know, you know, we've had I guess companies been thinking about this for a number of years now. Especially, I think it was triggered more so by the Companies Act in 2013, which actually made it the board's responsibility to look at the whole concept of enterprise-wide risk management. Very simply put, to say what are the top, 3-10 business risks that are, going to are critical to your business to, survive and continue to grow and sort of continue to run your operations. Now, clearly, I think this has tested, all aspects of any organization into a, risk management framework. And to me, the learnings really are that I think we all need to be better geared up. I think there's no doubt about that. But the ones, and I think Kaushal was talking about, how his organization has been investing in both the whole ESG paradigm. I think that will become, main, front and center now, and then will acquire a lot of focus. Because I think, interestingly, I was reading some research, all the ESG indexes are actually doing much better than the rest of the, the markets. And companies that higher up on ESG scores are actually...
Karan, that's a very important trigger for all of us. Yeah, tell us about the markets now. Let's go to the second focus area, that how the capital markets have taken us, I mean, what sort of a reaction has happened? And tell us something about that and what we should expect that the markets, how they will behave over a period of time.
So on a lighter note, I wish I had that foresight or the ability to tell you how the markets will sort of, which direction they will go. But I think more seriously, I would try and break this up into two parts. You know, one is looking at the public markets and the second is what's happening in the private equity world. I think as far as public markets go, we've all seen a tremendous amount of volatility, a lot of value getting eroded, especially in the first few weeks of the crisis as companies were still trying to come to grips with it, governments were trying to come to grips with it. And then again, sectorally, if we see it, it pans out across sectors. But again, clearly, if we go to the next slide, we will see that a number of the sectors were more severely impacted. And again, I think one has to keep this in context with what was happening, especially with our economy, even prior to the COVID crisis. I think we were going through a downturn. If you think about the auto sector, for example, they were looking at significant sales decline even through most of last year. And so I would say a lot of this is not necessarily driven by the crisis. I think the crisis was probably, again, just accretive to that value erosion. But it has been building up over a year, and I think this kind of exacerbated that situation because it came in at the fag end of the year and added to the misery that was already prevailing in the market. I think, and then again, before I come to what we expect going forward, it's also important to look at the private equity world. And I think there also globally we've seen how a number of companies that were actually doing quite well in terms of their valuations have seen their business go away, whether it's hospitality, whether it's travel. Again, those are not coming back, to full scale or to anywhere close to full scale anytime soon. So there a lot of value has gone away. And I think the question really there is that how does one bring that back? But on the flip side, I think we've seen, certain sectors and again, certain kinds of businesses do pretty well, even in terms of valuation. And those are the ones that are now are relevant in during the crisis. I think we spoke of healthcare, we spoke of FMCG, we spoke of consumer. I think all of those, because they are relevant and they continue to deliver products and services that are relevant in today's market. But to me, there are two or three trends that are coming out of this. And I think this is, again, based on all the research we do, based on conversations we've had with clients and with a number of investors. One, I think, hopefully, and this is a hope, that valuations will become a lot more patient. And by that, I mean that, while, again, markets always criticize in terms of their instantaneous reaction to any crisis or any, whether it's good news or bad news, But I think what this crisis is teaching us is that, again, if you look at communications put out by any of our public companies around the world, that there is, and you said it earlier, that with so much uncertainty, I don't think anyone can say, how will they recover fully from this crisis or when will they recover more importantly. So I think what we're hearing anecdotally, at least from a lot of investors, is that they understand that and they want the primary focus today is on survival. The primary focus today is on you know, the safety and health and safety aspects of your workforce, and also to prevent any further value loss, so to actually minimize the value loss. And then, you know, obviously start building up as you know, the crisis goes away, hopefully a cure is found, you start working back to actually start getting into growth more. So to me, that's one aspect. The second one is, which the one I was alluding to earlier, which is the focus on, you know, the whole ESG agenda. And I think today, safe to say, it's been more relevant, it is more relevant today than any other time in our history. And I think while a lot of companies are focusing on the E, you know, the E, environmental, social, and government governance, but I think the S and G are now becoming actually more relevant. And again, obviously, because we need to focus on, you know, how do we keep our workforce intact? How do we ensure our employees are, you know, safe and stay well? And then how do we keep them engaged? And then
so also, are you saying that value dimension of many of the companies will get also be looked at in this aspect too?
Oh yes, I think that's been building up, and I think we've all seen how relevant impact and social capital are becoming. A number of investors have, you know, large allocated pools for investing in socially responsible businesses that are causing or are creating positive impact for society, for the environment. I think that is a trend that will gather increasing momentum. And also, I think, like I said, the point on, you know, possibly more patience in terms of, you know, understanding that it takes time to emerge from such a crisis, and then obviously the consequence or the impact that it has on valuation.
Thanks, Karan. I think we seek more answers from the two CFOs who have been facing the investors regularly. And one question that I have from them also is that many people tell us that the market, Indian markets are going to lag, I mean, and the overseas markets are going to grow. I would want you to address that too. Is that true? That other markets will recover faster. Nitin, why don't you tell us something about your sector and your view of the capital market? You know a lot about that happening over the last two decades.
So as you can see, in terms of the Nifty Pharma, how it has moved in recent period, especially the last 3 months, which may be relevant you know, to consider the impact on pharma versus impact on S&P BSE 500 as an index. So you find that while in last 3 months, the returns were 6.70% for S&P BSE 500 index, so far as Nifty Pharma is concerned, the return is 43.5%, which shows the kind of impact which, you know, COVID-related opportunities, maybe you can say, or the market recognizing the importance of, you know, pharma sector has started giving that. Having said so, if I can, you know, quote Devang Bhai Nida Fazli here, who talks for the world, but I think it's equally relevant for the stock market. You know, when he says that, "Dunya jise kehte hai, jadu ka khilona hai, mil jaye to mitti hai, kho jaye to sona hai." So stock market are also very much akin to that. Having said so, let me talk about, you know, pharma industry to give a little broader perspective, you know, apart from this, you know, numbers. So, Keso, can you put the next slide? So, impact of, you know, this COVID in the current healthcare sector. So, just to tell you briefly, pharma industry is quite a sizable industry in India. You know, is about 1,42,000 crore. You know, is the size, roughly about $20 billion size of Indian pharma sector. It's considered an essential goods industry, which now everybody has also started recognizing what it means actually as essential goods industry. And it's also considered quite a defensive sector in the sense that whatever may happen to economy, you know, healthcare and pharma are here to stay, in the sense that, just say, you know, people say that gum may be PO or kusi may be PO. So the दवाइयां आपको चाहिए ही चाहिए ऐसा होगा. सो टू दैट एक्सटेंड इट इज अ डिफेंसिव इन दैट सेंस दैट इट इज क्वाइट एन इन इलास्टिक यू नो टू द इनकम ऑन अदर लेवल्स और इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ. हैविंग सेड सो आई टुडे व्हेन यू आर सीइंग 40 to 50% of their revenues coming from US business for most large companies, large pharma companies. So in US business, there happened a channel consolidation whereby large wholesalers like Walmart in ABCs of the world, they combined and consolidated their business, whereby, you know, they got a bigger negotiation power. And there are about three players in US who control almost 85% of the market. That's the kind of consolidation which has taken place. So that affected the margins of generic companies. Second, you know, with their GDUFA Act, you know, where they increased the fees, they also went for faster product approval, so which intensified suppliers and competition. And third was, you know, US FDA's actions on, you know, many, you know, Indian and other companies in terms of the regulatory actions, whether they are import alert or other kind of, you know, restrictions. So that also, to an extent, reduced the, you know, growth prospects of pharma companies, and that impacted the valuation. When it comes to India, in last 3 years, you know, you would have heard that Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced about making medicines available to masses at affordable prices, which led to reduction in prices of many branded formulations, and also emphasis given to pure generic business. So these factors affected, but in last 6 to 12 months, these factors have already, you know, given impact, and now, you know, it's up, uptrend. But that is getting reflected in the share market prices of pharma companies, and that is possibly aided by, you know, COVID related opportunities. This sector remains very attractive and has improved in last 1 year. Government has also recognized, like you have been, you know, hearing this, that most countries now do want to reduce the dependence on, you know, single countries, and especially country like China. And India government has also came out with the incentive, you know, scheme for API manufacturing. You know, India is dependent on China to some extent for API sourcing. So API is, you know, raw material for formulations. And government has nearly allocated 10,000 crore rupees to give incentives to API manufacturers for domestic market. As such, the market remains, you know, attractive because Indian pharma is the third largest in terms of volume and 10th largest in terms of value globally. Our cost of manufacturing are considered 30 to 40%, you know, lower compared to most countries. We also have a diversity in the sense that we not only manufacture normal tablets and capsules, we have injectables, we have transdermals, we have biosimilars, we have variety of, you know, products that we manufacture, including vaccines. And we have skilled manpower, you know, we have no dearth of, you know, skilled people, chemistry people, engineering people. And we also understand all regulatory reasons very well, you know, whether it is the US FDA regulations or UK regulations, Brazil regulations or Mexico regulations, Australia regulations. We are very much aware. We have people who know these regulations very well in the country, and therefore we are able to get good product approvals from these countries.
So Nitin, would you say that this sector is in for a large re-rating? Would you feel that?
Yeah, I think so, certainly. And recent report is that India, this industry is likely to reach $120 to $130 billion by 2030, which talks about 11 to 12% kind of CAGR. Obviously, this is at industry level, and people who are obviously better, well-placed and aspire more can expect, you know, even 15% plus kind of, you know, CAGR, which is certainly, you know, very good growth indicator. And what has helped currently for some of the companies, including Zydus, is how good you are in terms of, you know, your agility and execution, which we call in Zydus agility, you know, is the word, which means how quickly you can adapt to the requirements. You know, for example, look at, you know, the kits manufacturing for ICMR. You know, ICMR gave us this order, having talked to certain companies, and we are not only very fast, we took it, we started producing it very fast, gave first, you know, batch to, you know, ministry very soon in the same month. So this is the way, you know, we are able to take up new opportunities. When the government Masnavir is asked us, you know, whether we can increase the capacity of SCQS, we said, yeah, very soon, in next few months, we can, you know, make our capacity 3 times, 4 times, 5 times. You tell us, what is the capacity you want? So that is the kind of, you know, adaptability to requirements. Like hand sanitizer, people have known that Zydus, you know, introduced hand sanitizer. It was, you know, just about 20 days record time that from concept to execution this was done. So that's the kind of adaptability that, you know, we have shown.
Thanks, Nitin. Kaushal, your experience, how do you see the market? How do you see the valuations? How do you see the infrastructure sector growing up?
So Devang bhai, again, you know, I would like to emphasize on the word essential. You know, now, as you know, Nitin has already covered in this, but if you think through that, what is the essential, we'll have a better valuation moving forward. Like if you look at this in terms of which sectors which has performed well, like pharma obviously is an essential, as Nitin has mentioned, that nobody can live without the medicine. Similarly, you know, the consumer industry, you need the, you know, the foods and all of that stuff. That industry has also fared, that stock has also fared well. Similarly, if you ask me, infrastructure is backbone of any country. So if you ask today that, you know, in India, we have in the budget also, government announced that $1.4 trillion we are going to spend. And that will be spanning over to the roads and the rails and the airports and all of that kind of stuff which is going on. So moving forward, you know, how better we are geared up in terms of cash, because cash will be king. That's what I believe. And we at Adani also believes that moving forward, the cash will be a very, very important factors. Bottom line doesn't matter unless and until it converts into a cash. And the second, which Karan highlighted, very, very important, and we at Adani and in general, what we are doing is that we do assessment based on business importance and external perspective on the ESG front. Now, if you do that, then definitely, you know, you have a better market valuations, which is available. And then one is the requirement, essential things or not, that is number one. And then in this kind of environment, how we are geared up in terms of, you know, the environment, social, and more importantly, the governance. So I would like to emphasize on, you know, these particular aspects, that one is that, of course, infrastructure as a long 35-year contract. You don't have to worry for that. And, you know, like in Adani, we have in transmission business, we have again 35-year contract. The counterparty is also very, very strong. So we get the money regularly. But I would like to spend some time on the, you know, the ESG front. So what we are doing is that from the external perspective, what they are looking is that how you are...
Kaushal, we'll cover that as a separate item.
Okay.
In the form of what are the new opportunities that come, because that gives you a very different dimension of the business opportunities and also the new concepts of business. Okay.
Correct.
But am I right to assume that there'll be a lot of private sector enthusiasm in the infrastructure sector?
Yeah. There is a lot of opportunity which is there as of now into the various sectors, whether it is roads, and I have some data available with me, if I can, you know, if you can tell you that, you know, NHAI will be able to generate revenue of almost 14.31 billion from the toll. So there is a huge opportunity which is coming up. Government is giving massive push again of $25 billion into this. Into this sector, and that the private sector has a major advantage. Communication sector, we have a $5.36 billion which has been allocated. Similarly, on the railways also, if you look at, there is a $10.33 billion. So almost in all the sectors, if you look at this, there is a humongous opportunity which is available, and I don't see that moving forward, this sector will have any issue. In fact, this generates the large employment. This has been the biggest vehicle to revive the growth, I would say, that infrastructure sector.
And so then I think what you're saying is that some of the sectors that are of an essential category may possibly start the recovery in a big way. But none of you have answered my question. Will India lag, or will Indian markets, you know, be at the forefront? What is your wish list, or at least what is your thinking in that context?
India should lead, but my hunch is that India would follow.
Okay.
What about you, Kumran? Like a true consultant, I will say it depends. And I think on a serious note, I think really we need to see how the whole China situation pans out. I think we've all heard of a number of large businesses are potentially looking to relocate out of China and look at alternate geographies. So I think that's number one in my mind, at least. And if India, and I think the government's already announced its clear intention of bringing some of that investment into India. So if that does translate, I think we will see a very different picture emerge. And I think in the longer term, that obviously has benefits for us also. We have been pursuing Make in India for a long time. I think hopefully this will give a fillip to it. And I think now Make for India, I think that's the other theme. So I would say, again, I think it will be interesting to watch how that develops.
Thanks, Karan. Kaushal, you are on mute, I think.
You know, has a lot of opportunity. If you look at this, in the ease of doing business, we are doing a lot of transformation. Again, we have implemented the GST. We are creating a conduit of environment whereby, the external companies can come. We have eased most of the FDI rules. Even in the defense sector, now we have allowed 75% sake. So I believe that there is a huge opportunity for India in this environment to,
Let's ask the stakeholders, all of our participants, more than 400 people have joined us today. Thank you, guys. Let us ask them in the next poll question, how do they look at the capital markets? What they should focus on? Please answer in the vote for in the next 20, 35 seconds, please. This must have been an easy one. So can we, Karan, now begin with you on the actual method of communication? What are you suggesting to us, to our various participants who are stakeholders? They are also people who are responsible to the stakeholders. What is the mantra that you are giving them? That how communication to the stakeholders, how it should be managed, and what are the various dimensions? Could you please tell us?
Certainly, I think.
And the answer is very clear. Big chunk of the people are saying that we want a balanced triple bottom line structure down the line. So that's an indication. That's where we are moving towards too.
Yeah, that's become mainstream now, I think, clearly. So if I were to answer, I think moving on to the point that you raised on, how should companies be really addressing their stakeholders and investors? I think there's no secret sauce here, but I think if you really think about, if I were to take it at a very human level, all of us have, I guess, this thirst for knowing what's going on in, with all our stakeholders, right? Whether it's our family, our business, our employers, our, people we interact with. And I think similarly with investors, I think you have to realize that they are, very hungry for information. I think the one mantra that we do recommend is really that, it is important to keep investors engaged. And I think a lot of people have the apprehension that I don't want to go to my investors if I'm underprepared, if I don't have all the answers. And you would not have all the answers today because I don't think it's fair to even expect that of anyone, given the scale of this crisis and the the extent to which it is causing disruptions. But I think it pays to be transparent, it pays to be honest. And we do recommend that even if you don't have all the answers, say that, be honest about it, that yes, we are dealing with this, we are in this together. We've had, we've been, here's our plan in terms of how we address it. And we will come back to you when we have more information. There's nothing wrong with that. And a lot of companies have done that. So if SEBI came out with this requirement where it said that companies need to start talking to and even talking to the exchange and to the to SEBI about what is their COVID mitigation strategy or what is the impact of COVID on their results and their operations. And I think we've seen a lot of companies come up with fairly credible and honest and transparent communication to say, look, here's what we're doing, here's how we're dealing with it, and again, we'll come back to you when we get better information. The second thing we've seen happen is, and I'm sure both Nitin Bhai and Kaushal will agree with me, that a lot of senior management time is now getting spent. I'm not saying that this was not the case earlier, but I think the amount of time that senior management is spending to talk to investors, to talk to other stakeholders has gone up quite a bit. And I think we see that again, not just in the Indian context, but globally too. The better, the more well-governed, the better managed companies, the ones that are really keen on keeping their investors and stakeholders engaged, are going out of their way in that sense to really have adequate senior management attention being paid to that. And that's important again, because again, I think that's always been an ask, by whether it's by analysts or investors, that we need to hear from senior management. And that is most important, obviously, in the time of a crisis, because they really want to know that we are hearing from credible people and we are hearing credible answers. So I think that is the second point I would say. The third one, and I think most is also important to keep sight of, is while doing all of this communication, we still need to be very mindful of our regulations. And I think we've seen a lot of incidents where SEBI is really saying, you should, what you're saying or what you're doing today may constitute a violation of regulations. For example, related to unpublished price sensitive information. Again, given that valuations are depressed, we've had instances where there could be people who will, let's say, ready to take advantage of the depressed valuations. There was an instance in the US where pharma companies coming out with COVID cures, and their senior management selling stock through approved trading plans. So again, nothing illegitimate about it, but even that is being perceived negatively, to say, okay, you're making money in a crisis. By again serving a legitimate business need, it doesn't sound right. There is greed in this. So I think that is also a dimension that's very important. And I think, having spoken to a number of senior investor relations professionals too, personally also, I think it's something we need to be very conscious of, because you don't want to run foul of regulations in this keen and genuine sort of intent to talk to your investors and keep them informed. But let's be careful. I think the practical challenge it's also creating is, with board meetings getting deferred and AGMs getting deferred, the longevity of the silent period. And I would love to hear what both Nitin Bhai and Kaushal think about this. But the trading days are really getting compressed right now. Obviously there is anyway disruption in the market, but with the enhanced or the delays in reporting, the delays in the AGMs getting pushed out, how many days are you able to really keep your stock in the market and trade actively? It's also getting to be a problem.
Very true. Kaushal, Nitin, how has been your experience while talking to your shareholders and your stakeholders? What is it that you have done? How is it different and from the earlier communications?
So the communication in Zydus had two dimensions. One, how do we communicate internally what's going on during this COVID times, and how do we communicate to external stakeholders? So when it comes to internal stakeholders, the person at the level of chairman and MD, they talk to many people, employees in different forums, saying that for us the safety of our employees is paramount, and therefore several measures have been taken at plant as well as in office areas in terms of when the entry of employees done, who can actually come to office. Though we were allowed to operate the offices, but still we are not operating fully, still we keeping concern of COVID in mind. Those who would report to office also need to go through several checks and an online portal first, how to answer many questions. Once approved, then only they can come. And within office also, there are social distancing norms they are supposed to observe. Even in canteen, there were default times for different batch of employees to see that social distance gets maintained in canteen during lunch break also. That onwards, from the entry to sanitize, use of sanitizer and mask, gloves, everything, and measurement of temperature 2 times a day for all employees. So these are some of the measures that we have taken. And in terms of priorities of any kinds of let's say financial payments, employee obviously is the first priority, and that's very clearly communicated by chairman. When it comes to handling this, as an essential goods industry, we had very so to say different, difficult and very memorable situations also, you know, where we got tested for our, you know, slogan dedicated to life. You know, for us, you know, there have been messages given by, you know, president manufacturing, quality in charge of plants, how patient first and nation first, you know, principles we are living with. So there were many examples. Some I have mentioned here, like, you know, Ankur traveled 60 kilometers from Kanpur to Lucknow to deliver just two filled syringes to a professor in Lucknow, you know, who said that these medicines are not available in Lucknow. Can it be supplied? So my salesperson travels from Kanpur to Lucknow. In between was stopped by many people, obviously, including police. Everywhere, you know, he showed his identity card and said that I am working for pharma company and this is the purpose for which I am going.
Heroes.
And we published these stories also, you know, in various internal, you know, communication dashboards for other people to know how, you know, Zydus is addressing this. Secondly, is a Rahul traveled 500 kilometers. You know, he was at his place just after lockdown at, you know, Bandarpur, which is 500 kilometers, and there were no public transport obviously allowed, right? So he traveled on his motorcycle 500 kilometers to attend to his duties in plant. He said that when plant is allowed to be run and my plant manufactures medicines which are required, it is my duty to come to the, you know, plant and work. So this is a kind of, you know, messages which, you know, happen. Our employees, you know, there many of them stayed in nearby hotel because some of them were coming from one district to another district and movement across district were, you know, restricted, and therefore they said that they will not go back to their home, they will stay nearby hotel. There were
all these stories were internally communicated, and the, yes, stakeholders' confidence was increased, enthusiasm was also increased, right?
Correct. Yeah. And so there are people who, you know, actually, you know, stayed and slept in our plants. Okay, they said that they will not go back. Some of them were, you know, the new joinees who obviously during that period cannot get any rented accommodation in the nearby areas because everything was under lockdown. They said that we don't have place. We made arrangement for their stay, for their food and everything in our plant locations, made all temporary arrangements, and this worked for more than a month, okay, in terms of their stay. All those things we managed. Let me, Devang bhai, quote some lines which are from just a 62-year-old movie called Sone Ki Chidiya. Because the lines are very apt, you know, and this is the message which, you know, chairman owners, everybody was giving to all people. The lines, you know, go like this. Raat bhar ka hai mehman andhera, kiske roke ruka hai savera. Raat jitni bhi sangeen hogi, सुबह इतनी ही रंगीन होगी. गम ना कर घर है बादल घनेरा, किसके रोके रुका है सवेरा. तो सवेरा आने वाला है.
I think like a picture, the songs tells us everything, right? How was your experience with the shareholders?
Yeah, so when it comes to shareholders, you know, as earlier I mentioned, we had a call with investors just before lockdown, during the time when, you know, this started in China. Some of the investors and analysts started asking that because Indian pharma industry is to some extent dependent on China, how this can affect, and if this goes on, how are you gearing up yourself, you know, as a pharma company. So we already had a call with more than 100 people joining just before even formal lockdown. We also mentioned in February immediately that we are developing vaccine for COVID. We worked on COVID-19 kits. You know, ICMR gave this, you know, and selected us as a manufacturer. The first 30,000 kits were given free to the government. We increased our production capacity of SCQS, and because people knew that, you know, we are one of the largest global manufacturers and suppliers of SCQS. So, and chairman very clearly publicly announced that this is not the time to make profit, and this is very important, you know, as a message externally as well as internally.
That's a statement which is telling us, giving a very different insight about how the economic world is undergoing a change. Kaushal, why don't you share your experiences of how did you communicate and what all you did.
Yeah, Devang bhai, thank you so much. Nitin bhai, fantastic overview on your communication. So similarly, I would like to, you know, tell that on the stakeholder front, basically we divide, I mean, general penum understanding is that we limit ourselves to the employee and the shareholders. What we have done is that we covered the overall scenario. One is the our internal employee, and of course, as per the WHO guideline and various guideline issued by the local municipality and all of them, we have made sure that all the safety measures are provided. As mentioned that similarly, we have also, some of our employees have been quarantined at the substation. We always had a morning talk with them, and then we had some play and Antakshri and the video, all of that thing we used to do also in our company. But more importantly, I would like to tell you is that what we have done with the external stakeholders, which was very, very important. So these I would particularly divide, because we have a large international market exposure from the global overseas market. So for us, you know, the rating agency, because we are an investment grade company, so rating agency was one important external factors, you know, which we wanted to make sure that they have a complete comfort on where we are. The second was the, of course, the investors. The equity and the debt, both the investors with whom we had an interaction. The third one was the, you know, we also had a interaction with the partners and the vendors. And then the fourth one is what we have done is that we have done communication with our independent board also to apprise them of what is happening. So these are the broader four areas where we have done. So on the day the lockdown announced by the, you know, the Modi government, the next, you know, in couple of days only we sent a mail to all the, for example, we have a Fitch, Moody's and S&P, of course, all the companies, large companies like Zydus will have the same. So we engage with them. We from, you know, proactively had set up a call with them, and we took through them that what are the, how we are mitigating the various risks, because they have general questions about that. We had certain kind of top line, bottom line, everything we have communicated, and they had a feeling that with this environment, the entire thing will change, and how you are from the ESG perspective, how you are mitigating this risk. So we communicated very well to them about the, you know, how the business is going to be affected, how our growth story, where we were planning to do CapEx, what will happen to there over 12 months. Then we also, you know, communicated to them that what is the cash position and the receivable position, which will span out in this environment, because that is the biggest concern most of them. At least you will be able to sell your goods wherever you are, but are you able to receive the money or not? That was the biggest concern with all of them. So we did that immediately, and believe me, you know, 50% in the Asian markets, the rating were downgraded. While with this action, that gave a lot of comfort to them. The second thing, we immediately set up a call with the directly with the bondholders. And, you know, the equity investors, both of them, we have given them the update about what is right and wrong. And Karan rightly mentioned that you have to be transparent, because you have a peer group of companies also, and they also will be very, very clearly. So if you are not telling something, they will be able to anyway know. So we were very transparent in what are the area where we have to be a little bit cautious, where whether our growth will be of the same pace or CapEx is going to go up, down, how we are going to manage that entire situation. Then we also had a discussion with the small vendors and the large vendors. So small vendors, you know, we have given them a special privilege. And in this environment, we have supported them. We have supported from the technological, you know, support, so that they can, whatever based, they can provide a support, they can do it. So, and in, as a policy, we have made that of a certain amount, if the, when, is the amount is outstanding, then to this level of vendor, we will pay without any you know, further.
So would you agree with Karan that when he mentioned that a lot of senior management's time and energy was spent on this communication process?
Absolutely. We immediately, you know, the CEO, CFO, and our business head, all three were there continuously engaging for first 1 week. I mean, this pandemic, we immediately and we engaged with them. And we also, you know, had a special person, the email ID, of course, every company has investor relation head. I mean, guy. So, you know, they communicate if they have any questions, follow-on question also, they can come by. And then after we did the call with the independent directors also, which was very, very important because they are also very, very important stakeholders. And they also wanted to know that what is the situation which is going to happen to the company. And, you know,
They are also very true. They are also opinion makers to the world outside too.
Absolutely. These are the stalwarts of the industry. In fact, with their experience, you know, they have given a lot of suggestion also that in this crisis management, how do we handle the entire situation? And it was really a very, very interactive session. So I would say that, this is a very, very important things into this crisis environment to deal with your internal stakeholders, as Nitin bhai mentioned very clearly.
Effective communication is a very important dimension of the shareholder
stakeholder management. Yeah, and I forget to mention, we have written a letter, our CEO written a letter to all the stakeholders, I mean bondholders and the equity holders, that this is how we are dealing with the situation. So that also we did immediately in the first week itself.
Thank you, Kaushal, Nitin and Karan, great insights. As we move on to the last focus area of new opportunities, let's do a quick poll asking our stakeholders. This is a very important insight that we want from you people. What is this crisis management should center around? If there's a next crisis, how do you think we should be prepared? Please tell us in the next 30 seconds, please. Thank you. Karan, as we move on to the last portion of the focus areas, before you take the questions, we see a lot of questions coming in. So I think we'll have to spend a lot of time for that. Tell us, what is your insight? What is your view on how does the whole thing, as you said, and as even Nitin mentioned, there's always a hopeful sign. And post the recovery, you might possibly see a lot of change, the way in which how people have viewed, how they have suffered. What are your views on opportunity and future outlook, both in terms of the business profile, also in terms of the larger concepts? You mentioned something about risk management also. Are there new things that are going to come in terms of management processes, styles, etc. too?
Certainly.
And before that, as we just announced, of course, most of the people say that there would be a very clearly in the poll that there should be a government should rope in people and all, there should be a balanced way of economy as well as the livelihood focus. Thank you, stakeholders. That's what we wanted to hear. Thank you. Let's take it to the next level.
So thanks. And I think before I go into some of these points, I think I would just say personally, if you reflect upon, you know, again, having gone through this crisis now, and hopefully it's only once in a lifetime, all of us need to go through this, but I think it's a different world, you know, whether it's, and some of the questions also allude to some of these things that I'm going to talk about, but, you know, working from home, you know, we've been talking about it for years and years and years, but today the whole world switched to working from home overnight. And I don't think we've had any significant challenges in large parts of the economy. Yes, for manufacturing, of course, one needs to be there on the shop floor, but, you know, large part of the service economy is working, or even working better in some ways because there are no distractions, you don't have to travel. You know, the commute is gone. There is no, cooler room conversation happening that take away some time. So all of us are just sitting in front of our computers working nonstop. The environment, I think it's become, we've all heard of stories of how mountains have become visible. Our rivers are cleaner. The air is cleaner. I think those are positive, sort of solid positive outcomes that at least one hopes, you know, continue to stay. But I think as far as it coming back to the business world is concerned, and I think these will become mainstream focus areas for the business world also, you know, whether it's, you know, how do you keep your employees engaged? What should be the new mode of working? You know, is it work from home? Is it a mix of, you know, work from home and some people coming to work? You know, the whole focus on risk management. And I think this will now become a much more dynamic exercise. You know, while this was a number of companies embraced this, but a lot of companies, you know, adopted the check in the box approach that let's do it because the regulations ask us to do it. I think now this will, having gone through this, people will, you know, hopefully pay more attention to this and do it more often. Because clearly, you know, we are living in a volatile world and we need to sort of keep refreshing the risks that our businesses face so that we are equipped to deal with them. I think someone on the panel, on the box asked this question on technology and, you know, how relevant technology is. I think there's no other time when technology is more relevant. We, you know, doing this webinar with...
Karan, you already have a question on, will VFH be the new normal, which you already said, yes.
Yeah. I was seeing some of these, exactly. So I think from a technology perspective also, I think it's centric to everything we do today, whether it's this webinar, whether it's how we work, whether it's how we consume, you know, we're all sitting home ordering on the internet, you know, and that was a trend that was gathering pace, but now it's probably the only option in a lot of ways. ESG, I think, you know, Kaushal spoke about it and how, you know, they've adopted this, and so did Nitin Bhai, but I think to me, that's a very, very positive outcome. Again, something that was in the works, but now it becomes mainstream. I think the next one is really, you know, possibly long-term shifts in consumption. And by that, I mean, I think just being more responsible. I think we've had today, if you look at, you know, what sectors are doing well, it's really the, you know, the staples and, you know, the essential requirements. Conspicuous consumption, I think, has obviously taken a very strong hit.
So Karan, I want to play a devil's advocate here.
Sure.
You know, we go to a lot of leadership conclaves and we do a lot of spiritual 2-3 day programs, everything. And everything looks good till that time. After the 10 days, 1 month, we are back to normal, back to business as usual. Do you think this is what is going to happen, that people's consumption, people's way of living, is it really going to change, or you think it will be the, they call, business as usual?
I'll answer that in two parts. I think so. I was going to, in fact, talk about this when you interjected. I think one of the things is, you know, this whole concept of revenge consumption, right? That as soon as the lockdown opens, let's run out, let's buy everything that we wanted to buy all, in all our life, because who knows when the next crisis will happen and when the lockdown will force us to stop consuming again. And we've seen that happen. You know, China, for example, there were long queues outside luxury stores. Luxury cars are actually, you know, back up to pre-COVID levels in terms of demand in China, one hears, to the extent that, you know, all those factories are running double shifts now. So I think there is an element of that. I think that will happen. But I'm hoping that, you know, at least even if a percentage or, you know, some part of the conspicuous consumption becomes more responsible, it's a huge shift. And the reason that it gives me hope is that I think with the millennials especially, I think we've seen that, you know, already being very pronounced. I'll give you a very personal example. You know, my son tells me, you know, here in Delhi, you know, we're living in 43 degrees, but he stopped using the air conditioner at times. So he's saying it hurts the environment. You know, I don't want to damage the environment. And you know, I look at him and say, you know, that's not the best way to sort of save the environment. You'll fall sick. But it's a very good example of how this whole generation is moving away from, you know, just thinking about personal benefits and personal consumption. The amount of stories you've heard of, you know, little children or, you know, obviously a number of us, our colleagues, our friends, coming out and helping each other, helping, you know, society and people who don't have the means. So that gives me hope. You know, that's a sort of short answer to that. And then the last one is, again, all of us hope for that, you know, it gives India a sustainable advantage in, you know, gathering a larger share of and our justified share of the world economy, whether it's by, you know, again, more responsible consumption locally, or by, you know, gathering at least getting a larger share of the global supply chain.
Very true. Thank you, Karan. Great insights. Nitin, what are your views? What new thing that you see around the corner?
So as I earlier mentioned, pharma industry as essential good industry has lots of, you know, opportunities with 11-12% kind of CAGR expected till 2030. What is what has started changing and going to change is in terms of the use of technology. I think the new normal is certainly going to be different, whether it is use of digital technology in manufacturing environment, in marketing promotion, whether it's telemedicine or new ways of doctor patient engagement. Now somewhere this has to start, and obviously everything new has its own resistance level or risk level. But again quoting Nida Fazli, kise ke waste rahe kahan badalti hai, tum apne aap ko khud hi badal sako to chalo, safar mein dukh to hogi, jo chal sako to chalo, sabhi ye bheed mein tum bhi nikal sako to chalo. So I think this change has to be there, safar mein dukh to hogi, but naya kuch karne ka hai.
That's a great, extremely good line that you have said, and I think it will remain in our mind for a long time. Hopefully, it will result into a lot of action too. Kaushal, views
on Devang, just one second. I'll touch upon these two points. Especially.
Please. Zero. Yeah, go ahead.
I think it's the time for Indian industries to look at their cost from the zero base angle. This concept has been talked about quite a bit in various forums, but I don't think that on a very large scale at food organization level anybody has actually attempted this. While this might have been done in pockets, I think it's the real right time to work on zero base budget and revisit all the cost. And there are new areas like for healthcare, like immunity, boosters, these days talked about vaccination, sanitization. These are new areas apart from the normal conventional medicine. API manufacturing, as Karan also mentioned about India advantage. What is going to actually make a major difference is to become innovator. And Zydus is amongst the few companies who are making investment in terms of basic research, where obviously the probability of success is very, very low. You work on 100 different targets and none of them actually succeed and go to the next level. But our chairman is having a passion of innovation, and therefore he keeps telling all the people, the scientists who say that, sir, we have not succeeded, he keeps saying that ruk jana nahi tum kabhi haar ke kaanton pe chal ke milenge saaye bahar ke.
Very true. So, Karan, I hear a lot of people are getting into very different business models. There is a startup doing yoga classes online. There are very new ideas that are coming up. You think this is all this will have a great boost for after this, after the COVID crisis?
Personally, I think yes. And I think, of course, a number of these businesses may not scale up to be large businesses. But I think what's happening is this whole trend towards what I call micro consumption, or a lot of people call hyper local, right? That you are essentially looking at consuming what's relevant for you, consuming something that has minimal economic environmental footprint, and gives you something more than just that benefit of consuming it. And by that I mean the softer aspects of whether it's farm to fork, whether it's adding to your health, or making you more fit. So I think those kinds of businesses will continue to grow. And I think once you're right, we've seen a lot of them sort of come up and become more relevant. I think this ethical sourcing, tracing.
You're actually getting a totally new breed of entrepreneurs now. Very different. Oh,
yeah.
Kaushal, let us talk more on how do you want to see stakeholder management, new dimension, the ESG dimension. Tell us what you have done, and tell us how is it so important for you?
Well, so Devang bhai, one thing which we have learned, and we all have to learn, all the business, is that it cannot wait for transformation. Now, transformation can be of technology, transformation can be of your products, supply chain, but moving forward, the consumer taste and the preferences are going to change completely. And we have to make sure that, I was hearing one of, these things, where in the villages, in this COVID environment, in a consumer industry, where, the sales guy want to understand that what is the sales numbers and how is the stock position at the various locations. And now, this things with this technological transformation provided both to your partners, which are the, you know, the your consumers or a vendor, plus your own company and the, you know, the stock depot manager, is very, very essential to make sure that. And also this has helped us to do a meetings across globe. When, you know, Nitin bhai must be experiencing that he can do meeting at the night also 9 p.m. and in the morning also across the globe. And this, you know, this online environment has created a wonderful thing. So coming back to the ESG, and Karan made the right things. What is more important is that globally, the stakeholders, when they want to invest, I mean, particularly the investors, they have a clear-cut mandate about the ESG parameters, which in the company in which they are investing, they must validate. And there are two types of funds which are there. One is purely an ESG fund base, where they only invest where, you know, ESG compliant, or they, you may be getting a higher score. And this, and those who are doing the integrated reporting. By the way, Adani Transmission is the first company in this sector to, you know, do the integrated reporting as per standard. So, and then the advantage of this is, if you follow this ESG, then your cost of borrowing, in fact, will come down at least by 1.5%. And we have experienced this. Now, let me explain you what we have done. For example, on the environment side, we were, you know, having for the distribution business, small integrated power plant. So we had to procure some coal. We have now decided and communicated very clearly that 30% of our procurement will be from the renewable sources. So now this has now, you know, there was Paris Accord, whereby most of the companies has to comply with that standard by 2030. But we as an, you know, company will be complying this standard in next 2 years, much ahead of the schedule. Similarly, at our various, you know, we have a substation, we have done the water harvesting kind of a situation. So what are you giving back? If you are producing something and which is impacting the environment, the global funds and all of them are not interested. Similarly, on the social front, how you are making sure that the upbringment, upliftment of the life at the various sites, which is happening where your sites are there, and how do you contribute to the society, whereby making sure that the, you know, the general level goes up, living standard goes up. And the last front which we have done is on the corporate governance, whereby, you know, we have made sure that we have an independent board, where independent committee, and then the no promoter is being is there. And then on the, we do the assessment based on the business important and external perspective. So we do the, how much is the report, how much is asset utilization, how is our labor relation with the various portion, because that also in this environment, they are expecting us to maintain this. How is our supply chain practices? So it is not only Adani, we are following the practices. When you choose your partners, they also should have these practices being followed. So more and more you do this, you know, you will have a better accessibility from the global market for this. And then they are looking at the business ethics, innovation and the technology.
So your larger pieces of ESG become part of your actual business model. That's absolutely the takeaway that we are giving. Yeah, very good.
I am also part of one of the committee of institute, whereby, you know, there is a standard which is now coming up sustainability, and where this actually you will be able to see the impact on your profit and loss account. So this will happen probably in next 1 year, that how this your companies has impacted the environment, that actual materially it will be reflected in your P&L account. So all that kind of things are coming up.
Thank you, Kaushal. In fact, thank you, Karan, thank you. Kaushal and Nitin. I hope the stakeholders, all of our participants, have enjoyed in the last more than 1.5 hours. We will take up a few questions. The first question, Karan, that I want you to answer, which is a very important question, coming from Vinita, Ms. Vinita. How does the role of HR now change at a fundamental level, Karan? A very interesting and extremely powerful question.
So I think my personal view is, I think we all have, realized that, and I think again, some of the progressive companies are already doing this, that employee health and safety is now getting far more attention and prominence. I think the whole employee engagement issue, again, especially when you're working from home or working remotely, how do you keep people engaged? Someone was mentioning earlier on the panel that they've been doing these quizzes and competitions. Similarly, at the firm, we've been doing virtually daily interactions to keep our employees engaged, whether it's yoga or motivational talks or exercise or health related lectures, etc. I think the other interesting aspect that I'm hearing, and a lot of people are paying attention to now, is also how do you monitor employee efficiency and well-being while you're away. One is the aspect of, are people doing what they're supposed to do? And the second, and I think someone again asked that question also, was that you also run the risk of people burning out far faster because they're working nonstop, they're working in a on their own, there is no social interaction. A lot of we are social animals at the end of the day, so a lot of that is now not happening because we all stuck in front of our computers mostly. So I think again, so employee health and safety, the centricity of that, employee engagement, and then also I think ensuring that that we have optimal productivity. And by that I don't mean that necessarily ensuring that they're doing what they're supposed to do, but also not overdoing what they should not be doing.
Great. Karan, Nitin, a question for you from Ravish. How much of the pharma industry depend on China? In view of the current situations, will raw material be difficult to source? And more important, do you feel the government may impose anti-dumping duty on China?
So for few of the products, as you would have also read, which are in antibiotic segment, like penicillin and certain other products, we have larger dependence in terms of raw materials. For other formulation products, I'm just giving just rough indicator that if there are 60 different raw materials required, maybe for 6-7 we are dependent on them. In other cases, there are APIs available from other countries also, including European countries like Italy. Somewhere China has in the past scored on terms of cost part, and that is why larger dependence which India and many other countries have on China. But I don't think there is going to be any significant or material problem because of that. One, currently the supply is fine. In fact, one just after month or so was ready to start the factories and have the supplies. What had affected the supply chain in pharma was more in terms of freight. So all the companies were not operating. The existing companies started increasing the freight. Also in terms of supply, because the passenger flights were not there, for certain costly medicines which were earlier used, you had to use some special flights, and that also has a cost element. So there was a cost increase in terms of freight. There were some delays happening, like in customs clearance also, some delays happening with the shortage of staff there in terms of clearance. While even custom clearance is essential, but then obviously there was not full staff, because some of the people who are working are located in lockdown areas, then there is no public transport, and therefore they are not positioned to attend to the duties. All these issues were there which affected the supply chain, but otherwise in terms of movement of goods, no issues. Talking specifically in India, because there is a branded formulation business and most doctors were not operating their OPD, that affected the movement of people, as because of MRs normally go and meet doctors. If the doctors are not there, to whom they are supposed to meet, so that was also an issue. But gradually all these issues are now getting settled. But in the rest of the markets, including USA, the business was quite standard without any kind of interruptions.
Kaushal, there's a prediction that you have to do. Tapan is asking, how long will we take to come out of the COVID-19 and return to previous valuations?
This is a million-dollar question. I think what we have to do in this environment is to make sure that we deliver as per the regular norms, and it will take a lot of time. I personally believe that the way it is going on currently, at least another six, but we have to learn how to live the life with this pandemic, with all the safety measures. How do we handle the entire things? And if you are in the right sector and the right kind of a company and your business model, then here is an example of Reliance, where of course they must be working it for more than 6 months or 9 months or a 12 month for this Jio decision. But of course, you can fetch the valuation if your business model is right, and if you are able to present that the model is not going to be impacted majorly, and there is a sustainability behind this.
There is very clearly a differentiator aspect.
Yeah,
very true.
Correct.
Related to that, we have a question both to you, and we'll just take another one or two questions more. Question to you and Nitin. What is the level of, please comment on the process automation in Adani and Zydus respectively.
So automation, I think, is an ongoing journey, and several processes. I believe that Adani, obviously, as a larger group, is quite ahead in general in terms of processes. But in pharma, looking at the industry, which is highly regulated industries and document driven industry, there is still a lot of paperwork required in terms of records keeping, what one has taken in terms of measurement, what reading is taken, what temperature is taken. But a lot many processes in the manufacturing environment are also getting documented in terms of soft copies rather than hard copies. So that's the journey we are going at. And just to touch base the previous question which was asked to Kausar in terms of where the market and what is the prediction. I of course you all know that Vijan Daruwala was not making more money than Rakesh Jhunjhunwala.
Yeah.
Astrology does not help.
Yeah, very true. Kaushal, on the initiatives, I think a lot of work is going on in terms
of... Yeah. So what we did was that whether COVID or no COVID, we have now very clearly established and given a priority on our process part. And we have a centralized control room at the Adani Corporate House itself. So whereby, you can see sitting here all the plants' important parameters by the SCADA system. So any deviation or any interruption at the plant level or a PLF level or any interruption at the substation is happening, you will be sitting in a control room, you will be able to see that and then pass on message to the respective sites to correct that.
Use of technology in the years to come, especially to manage such crisis situations, is very important. I think all organizations Absolutely. Are now focusing on that. Karan, yes. One question for you. Indo-China relations and the impact on the Indian economy and the financial sector. What is your gut feeling? How will it evolve?
And I'm not sure I'm qualified to answer that question, but I'll tell you my personal view. I think one, obviously in the short term, it will likely cause some disruptions again, adding to what we already have in terms of issues around raw materials, because again, whether we like it or not, a lot of what we consume today comes from China, whether it's at a personal level or at, as the country at large. But I think, like I said earlier, I think, again, it also then forces the issue on, sourcing locally and, producing more locally, and not just for us, for the rest of the world also. So I think it's a mixed bag. I think short-term possibly something, and it will depend on how long this crisis lasts. I think both countries are obviously working together to hopefully resolve this sooner than later. But also, I think we also have to keep in mind the geopolitics that are going around all over the world in terms of, the origin of the virus and, what's going on between the US and China, for example, Japan.
Finger-pointing. Lots of finger-pointing is happening,
And Japan has announced, pulling out of China to and giving money to its companies to actually, set up base elsewhere. So are a number of other countries. So we'll have to see how that pans out. I think most critical for me is that we put in place, and the government has been working on it, but we put in place the enabling mechanism for attracting more and more businesses that may be looking to relocate. I think one trend also is that this whole concept of near sourcing or onshoring, where everyone wants to now have similar to us. When we are saying we want to have control over what we consume and produce it locally, I think a lot of countries are saying that. So we'll have to see how it pans out.
Thank you. One last question that is addressed for me, but I will put it up to you guys. Is online education the next big thing? So from a business perspective, yes, it's ready for disruption. From a angle of a long-term play, it was always there. A lot of virtual way in which how teaching has come in. I think what is more important is now people will look at really the time that they spend in the school and the college can be effectively properly utilized along with technology. So I think, yes, there is going to be a lot of technology play. There has to be a lot of virtual online education that will happen. But anytime you would love to go back to the classroom, have a look, talk to people, share their experiences, do projects together. So there has to be a blended effect. But yes, there is very definitely a big push now. And I think that's what I think you guys also feel like, right?
Yeah, I would agree with you. I think we've already seen that happen. But I think we also need to keep in mind our internet penetration rates across the country, the access people have to online. Again, while a lot that's been growing, I think there's still a large section of the population that will or still does not have access to smartphones, for example. But there's a lot of innovation going on there also. People are using SMSs and WhatsApp and text messages and everything to teach. So I think that trend is here to stay.
Just on a lighter note on this Indo-China part, Prime Minister Narendra Modi is asking Nitin Bhai, what should we do? So yeah. I'm going to advise him that. But having said so, on a lighter note, I think it's going to be new equilibrium where all the economies and countries, including India and US, will have to balance the self-reliance and cost efficiency. And there will be new equilibrium, new normal, which will be certainly different than what is today, but it's not going to be that you are 100% self-reliant because they may not make economic sense.
No, either Nitin Bhai, one thing that I love is that if the sense of humor prevails, then we will not have too much of confrontation. I think with that, we end the discussion today. Thank you, gentlemen, for taking out the time. Thank you, friends, for participating in a large manner. And a big thank you for my backup team. Every one of us has worked over it and has made this happen. Thank you.
Thank you all.
And have a great day. Thank you all.
Thank you
for patiently hearing us. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Okay.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Chala bhai. Thank you.
No problem.